closed captioning for News 12 is brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, News 12, first at 5, continues.
Good evening, it's February, and communities are gearing up again for Black History Month. Augusta's Municipal Building putting up its Black History Month showcase. You can go check out photos of local figures and places. The display appears here once a year.
Our Claire Allen joins us now live in the newsroom to bring us what efforts local communities are making this month. And Claire, what are leaders up to, and how do they hope to create a lasting impact?
Recent gun violence in Augusta is taking a toll on minority communities, especially within many victims being Black. Now community leaders are hoping the start of Black History Month will be the start of positivity. Black History Month is a time to uplift and educate about African American culture and history. The National Action Network of the CSRA is hoping to do that, empower and empower local youth. Ahead of their Know Your History, Know Your Rights speech and poem competition, the group will host a workshop at Wallace Brands Library. It will provide resources and coaches for anyone who wants to participate in the competition. Organizers hope events like this not only educate the community, but inspire people to live up to their potential.
Black history means to me just greatness. It can remind us of where we used to be and where we can go.
It means it's a recognition of awesomeness in our culture. It's a time where we can take a special pride.
Coming up in the next half hour, we'll talk to leaders more about events like this and how they can help the Black community.
Claire, thanks for that. Taking a look now at a couple of other upcoming events. On Wednesday, Augusta Tech hosting a program called The Power of Telling Black Stories. That starts at 1 in the ITC Auditorium Building. Friday, the Augusta Museum of History holding events all day long, including stories, West African drumming, a movie about the civil rights movement here in Augusta.
Taking a live look outside, our agents said the FBI is always conducting intelligence and will contact any department if there is a threat.
Changing gears now, fentanyl is fueling a record-setting number of overdose deaths here in Georgia and South Carolina. And despite the warnings, officials say they expect even more people to die in 2022. They say many of those people just don't realize they're taking until it's too late. The DEA says there are some signs you can look out for to see if a pill might be counterfeit. Look for unsmooth edges. Look for craters on the outside. And maybe letters or numbers that don't look quite right. They say while you can't see fentanyl, if the pill is fake, it's probably laced with it. In commission today, city leaders approving a new speed hump policy. Every commissioner says last year they got requests for speed humps in neighborhoods. We've seen drivers running into fences and mailboxes, even homes. But this new policy makes it easier and more affordable for you to get a speed hump installed in your neighborhood if everyone agrees. Each district will be allocated enough money to place 4 humps a year. A few commissioners say they might even look at adding one where they live.
I had a situation in my neighborhood. 2 or 3 instances where cars were speeding so fast through intersections that they actually hit homes. They ran into gates and hit homes. My home was one of those.
Augusta Traffic and Engineering already has 8 neighborhood speed hump petitions this year, but with the new policy, you can see more being built. We're going to have a closer look at that ahead on News 12 at 6 o'clock.
If you're looking for a job, here are a couple of opportunities coming up this week. Augusta National hiring for this year's Masters Tournament in April. They're hosting 2 job fairs at 2505 Washington Road. Those will be Thursday from 2 until 6 o'clock and Saturday from 9 to 1. Meanwhile, SRP Park hosting a fair on Saturday from 10 to 2 for season positions. You're encouraged to register online before heading out that way. Check out our website for more information as well as some other opportunities. A former Georgia Bulldog is
today.
Okay, parents, here's a program you need to know about. Puddle Ducks at Finnessy Swamp, getting young kids out into nature while teaching them about what they're seeing. Our Will Volk takes us there and shows us how the walk today all came down to one single letter.
We are going to be learning all about the letter T in nature.
For these toddlers, this day is all about the letter T.
We just pick letters that we think there are lots of things you can find that start with that letter outside.
You could call this a twig.
Camilla Sherman teaches puddle ducks at the Finzi Center. She says this program does a great job exposing kids to nature.
There are so many cool things to touch and smell and really get all your senses going.
Yeah, we're going for a hike.
These toddlers get to take a trip down the trail. Their goal is to find as many tea things as possible.
So many trees! A tadpole! Ooh, good one, John John. They're more likely to not be afraid of new things if they're exposed to what's going on outside.
That's not all. Keeping with the tea theme, they made a tea using rocks. They had story time with the turtle and created their own turtle.
We absolutely love the program.
Laura Cole's kids have been running around here for the last 2 years.
We were new to the area a couple years back and found this program, and I have to say it's probably one of the best ones that we've enjoyed.
It's something many families enjoy, being outside with your kids, learning about nature. By the swamp, Will Volk, on your side.
And now they can add another tea to the list. Television. Good job, kids. Well done. Puddle Ducks meets on the first Tuesday of the month. You can sign up on the Finnessy Center's website. We highly recommend it, Mayor.
Here's another Tea Tuesday.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun out there. Chief Meteorologist Riley Hale, and the weather's pretty good. At least it was for them today.
Absolutely.
Tuesday.
Yeah, glad the weather helped.
From the station that's on your side, this is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
Three fires in three different counties, all in the last 24 hours. It's an active fire season all across the river region. We're going to hear from our American Red Cross team helping local families every single day.
But first tonight, new developments in the vaccine rollout for kids. We're learning children under the age of 5 could be eligible by the end of this month.
AU Health telling us it expects Pfizer to file for approval any day now. And it comes at a good time. Going to give you a look at the ages of kids hospitalized right now at the Children's Hospital of Georgia. There are 14 total patients, 10 of them under the age of 5.
And just in the last few hours, Aiken County Schools released these new COVID numbers. Last week, the county said it had 280 student cases with close to 2,000 students in quarantine. That is the highest number of cases and quarantines in younger elementary school students that we've seen.
And there are new guidelines out for South Carolina schools to help keep more kids in the classroom and out of quarantine.
It's called the Test to Stay program. We've got News 12's Will Rio with a look at the changes.
Making adjustments and rolling with the punches is how local school districts have made it this far.
You make small adjustments even with each of the variants or the surges that we've had.
Small changes as more students end up in quarantine because of positive COVID exposure.
We've had certainly some difficulty with that, you know, as the COVID positive COVID numbers have increased.
But DHEC is encouraging the Test to Stay program, and Aiken County says they're looking into it for students.
We'll just have to take a look at it and see if the, you know, implementation of Test to Stay is something that is feasible for our school district.
The hope is to keep more students in class and eliminate the need for exposed students to automatically quarantine. And here's how it works. It allows students exposed to stay in class if they test negative between day 5 through 7 and are not experiencing symptoms.
There are certain requirements for documentation. And so, you know, documentation and information and communication, those all require folks.
A second test is given 24 hours after the first. The only issue is Aiken County, already dealing with staffing problems, would have to find a way to staff the program.
If we don't have the folks to accurately be able to implement it, then it's not really feasible for us.
In Aiken County, Will Rio, on your side.
DHEC says they've ordered more than 1.6 million rapid at-home tests. 300,000 of those will get to schools by the end of this week. Aiken County tells us they do expect to learn more specifics when they get more information from DHEC on Thursday.
To weather now, as we give you a live look outside.
We'll have a look at that in just about 10 minutes.
Riley, thank you. It is an active fire season for the river region. Just in January, the American Red Cross says it helped close to 100 people impacted by fires, and that's just on the Georgia side. We also just saw three fires in three counties, all in the last 24 hours. News 12's Craig Allison live for us now from Moore Road in Augusta, where a home just caught fire yesterday. Craig?
Yes, Richard. Now, behind me is one of the more extreme fires that occurred yesterday, but it's just another example of the fire surge that's recently hit the CSRA.
One of the best things that people can do is to avoid a home fire before it happens.
Although fire season is at a destructive pace in the CSRA, all of the communities within the Augusta Housing Authority have been able to avoid these fires thanks to contingency plans with the Red Cross.
The longer term for us would be us identifying a property that we could transfer them over to. In addition, you know, we work with the Red Cross closely.
The Red Cross has identified some of the leading culprits for household fire starters. Things like heaters left on close to combustible materials, neglected kitchen spaces, and cigarettes in bedrooms.
Home fires really are just prevalent, you know, and it seems like they have just increased year after year after year.
The increasing danger has not stopped them from providing a variety of resources to people in need.
It can be things such as finding a long-term housing assistance. It can be helping with their medical issues, replacing prescriptions, replacing eyeglasses, and certainly some mental health as well. So while we hate that they are happening, you know, we're glad that we're able to help people in their hour of need.
Now, for more information on fire safety and resources, you can visit redcross.org. In Augusta, Craig Allison, On Your Side.
A million details those families have to count on the Red Cross to help supply, and we do appreciate that effort. Craig, thanks so much. You can't be too careful this time of year. Laura?
One man is now behind bars charged in an armed robbery at an Augusta Waffle House. 18-year-old Jalen Jackson in custody. Deputies say he's accused of pointing a gun and demanding money from the cashier, getting away with at least $500. The search is still on for this car, wanted in connection to the shooting death of an Augusta teen. Authorities tell us they found 19-year-old John Drick Oliphant shot dead in the street last Friday. They're now looking for a 2016 to 2019 blue Nissan Sentra in connection to this case. We want to bring in News 12's Sloan O'Cone live now. She's in our newsroom. And Sloan, the Richmond County Sheriff tells you that case is part of a bigger pattern in picture.
Exactly. Sheriff Rontree says the culture of violence in these areas is changing. It's becoming more cyclical. Yesterday, we talked about an overall generational trend, but today he shares the connections of it all.
You know, we kind of get a grasp on it because we have a reason behind it. There's an underlying nexus to why these things happen.
The sheriff says almost all of these crimes are connected to gangs, drugs, and or guns. Commissioner Dennis Williams, who's seen much of this crime happen in his district, says these actions are hard to prevent.
The type of violence that we're having is not well thought out violence, it's reaction violence, in my opinion. The nature of the crimes that we have now is different than it used to be years ago.
A culture that's changing.
Now we have a culture of violent offenders who have perpetrated violence, and that violence is now stemming back to that individual.
The sheriff says 19-year-old John Drick Oliphant was part of that culture. He was shot and killed on Stone Road on January 28th.
He had active murder warrant on him. We were closing in on him to apprehend him from a murder that was committed back in December, even though he was deceased. In this particular case, drugs and a weapon was found on him. That is a cultural lifestyle that very well probably led or contributed to his early demise.
The sheriff's office is asking for your help finding this car, which they believe was used in connection to his murder, because the sheriff and Commissioner Williams say they can't do this without you.
I think that we have to play by ear and hopefully be encouraging to the community and get them to be more involved.
The sheriff's office wants to emphasize Augusta overall is not a dangerous place to live, and Sheriff Rountree says they're using all of their resources to keep us safe.
Okay, interesting hearing all the behind the scenes and what they're doing to try to put an end to this, Sloan. Thank you.
So to come on News 12 at 6 o'clock, Black History Month is here. We're going to show you how the River Region is celebrating this year. Riley.
And we are starting off the month of February. It looks like that cold air will stick around in the next week, too.
It's the first day of Black History Month, and you can see the municipal building paying tribute with a showcase downtown. Features local trailblazers and historic locations that really help shape history here at home. And if you want to stop by, you can find it on the very first floor through the month of February.
And we're seeing other local groups step up right now to celebrate Black history and culture. Later this month, a speech and poem competition is just for young people.
Our Claire Allen talked to the organizers about how important it is to give kids a voice.
Black history
means to me, disgraceness.
It means it's a recognition of awesomeness in our culture.
Black History Month is a time to uplift and educate about African American culture and history. The National Action Network of the CSRA is hoping to do that with a new type of event this month.
We're hoping that this event actually inspires the youth to know their potential, to see their potential by learning their history, learning their rights, and getting connected with law enforcement.
The way that we help one another is we empower each other with knowledge.
In a couple of weeks, this library in the heart of Lady Walker will be full of kids learning how to use their voice.
This workshop is going to serve as a place where they can get resources here at Wallace Branch, area where they can rehearse. There are going to be coaches here to coach and mentor those that have never spoke in front of people and kind of give them an opportunity to sharpen their skills.
Community leaders hope Black History events can help curb gun violence in the Black community and spread positivity.
I want to give the youth a beacon of shining light so that they can look forward to a more positive future.
This is still in our kids, very young and at different stages of their life. Confidence, self-esteem, also knowledge.
Not only educating the community, but inspiring people to live up to their potential.
Because at the end of the day, this is our community, and they serving the community.
The question has to be asked, if not you, then who? If not now, then when?
In Augusta, Claire Allen, on your side.
And the Know Your History, Know Your Rights speech and poem competition, that's February 19th from 2 to 5 at the A.R. Johnson Auditorium. The workshop is happening next week, the 7th through the 11th, from 3:30 to 4:30. And if you want to learn more about how to get involved, you can contact Morris Porter at the email on your screen or through the National Action Network.
So taking a look at some other Black History Month events for you. Tomorrow, Augusta Tech hosting a program called The Power of Telling Black Stories. That starts at 1 in the afternoon in the ITC Auditorium building. Then on Friday, the Augusta Museum of History holding events all day long, including stories, West African drumming, and a movie about the civil rights movement right here in Augusta. Still ahead in sports, Tom.